Blackstone Audio presents Not Long Before the End by Larry Niven. This book is read by Bronson Pinchot.
Not Long Before the End. A swordsman battled a sorcerer once upon a time. In that age, such battles were frequent. A natural antipathy exists between swordsmen and sorcerers, as between cats and small birds, or between rats and men. Usually the swordsman lost, and humanity's average intelligence rose, some trifling fraction. Sometimes the swordsman won, and again the species was improved, for a sorcerer who cannot kill one miserable swordsman is a poor excuse for a sorcerer. But this battle differed from others. On one side, the sword itself was enchanted. On the other, the sorcerer knew a great and terrible truth. We will call him the Warlock, as his name is both forgotten and impossible to pronounce. His parents had known what they were about. He who knows your name has power over you, but he must speak your name to use it. The Warlock had found his terrible truth in middle age. By that time, he had traveled widely. It was not from choice. It was simply that he was a powerful magician, and he used his power, and he needed friends. He knew spells to make people love a magician. The Warlock had tried these, but he did not like the side effects. So he commonly used his great power to help those around him, that they might love him without coercion. He found that when he had been 10 to 15 years in a place, using his magic as whim dictated, his powers would weaken. If he moved away, they returned. Twice he had had to move, and twice he had settled in a new land, learned new customs, made new friends. It happened a third time, and he prepared to move again, but something set him to wondering, why should a man's powers be so unfairly drained out of him? It happened to nations, too. Throughout history, those lands which had been richest in magic had been overrun by barbarians carrying swords and clubs. It was a sad truth, and one that did not bear thinking about, but the Warlock's curiosity was strong. So he wondered, and he stayed to perform certain experiments. His last experiment involved a simple kinetic sorcery set to spin a metal disc in midair, and when that magic was done, he knew a truth he could never forget. So he departed. In succeeding decades, he moved again and again. Time changed his personality, if not his body, and his magic became more dependable, if less showy. He had discovered a great and terrible truth, and if he kept it secret, it was through compassion. His truth spelled the end of civilization, yet it was of no earthly use to anyone. So he thought. But some 5 decades later, the date was on the order of 12,000 BC, it occurred to him that all truths find a use somewhere, sometime. And so he built another disc and recited spells over it so that, like a telephone number already dialed but for one digit, the disc would be ready if ever he needed it. The name of the sword was Glirendri. It was several hundred years old and quite famous. As for the swordsman, his name is no secret. It was Belhap Saddlestone Wordless Ag Miraclot Oru Konansen. His friends, who tended to be temporary, called him Hap. He was a barbarian, of course. A civilized man would have had more sense than to touch Glirendri, and better morals than to stab a sleeping woman, which was how Hap had acquired his sword, or vice versa. The Warlock recognized it long before he saw it. He was at work in the cavern he had carved beneath a hill when an alarm went off. The hair rose up, tingling along the back of his neck.
"Visitors," he said.
"I don't hear anything," said Sharla, but there was an uneasiness to her tone. Sharla was a girl of the village who had come to live with the Warlock. That day she had persuaded the Warlock to teach her some of his simpler spells.
"Don't you feel the hair rising on the back of your neck? I set the alarm to do that. Let me just check."
He used a sensor, a slender silver hoop balanced on edge.
"There's trouble coming. Sharla, we've got to get you out of here."
But Sharla waved protestingly at the table where they had been working.
"Oh, that. We can quit in the middle. That spell isn't dangerous."
It was a charm against love spells, rather messy to work, but safe and tame.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.